As we come in today, looking forward to church. This past week has been a busy week for us, and I'm sure it's been a busy week for a lot of people. I want to preach today on a subject of, will there be a well done for you? Will there be a well done for you? That's my thoughts today. And the idea behind that is it worth it? Is your service to God worth it? So as we come in today, I want you to be thinking about that. Our scripture for the month is John 3:7. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. He said, don't think I'm crazy because I'm asking you or telling you. He said, but you have got to be born again. You've got to be. He said, don't think I'm crazy. Just marvel not. Today's the deadline to order wild game t-shirts. Link on the church Facebook page or sign up in the hallway. But today is the last day. So need to get those orders in, if you would. Also, next Sunday morning, Brother Chris Childs with God's Pit Crew will be here for the morning service. He's going to bring his ministry, and we support him monthly. He's one of our missionaries, and glad to have Brother Chris come. Listen, a guy that's out there on the front line, that's never home, that's out making sure not only is people's homes getting repaired after storms and things cleaned up, but he's sharing the gospel everywhere he goes. Those are the kind of people that we want to support their ministry. So Brother Chris will be here next Sunday morning. We'll take up a love offering for him as well. Yeah, we support him every month, but we'll take up a love offering as well to help out with ministry stuff. We have a wedding shower for Brittany and Cade on March the 5th. 10 to 12 here at the church. Ladies, please bring breakfast food. I never heard of a breakfast shower. That's awesome. Was there grits? Man, that's even better. I've had grits for 3 days. Well, I didn't have any today, but today's still young. I could have it still. The monthly manna is March the 12th. Brittany and Cade's wedding is March the 19th. Amen. Wild Game Supper is March the 26th and the 27th. You say, Brother Rex, the 27th? Yes, because it flows over into Sunday. The man that's coming, Brother Brian Alexander, will be coming. He'll preach that morning service. He's an evangelist. He'll preach that morning service for us. Our prayer is that he comes that Saturday night and people want to come back and hear some more. So that's the prayer. It's like the school bus just came in. Amen. Glad y'all came. Any other announcements? Any other announcements? Say it again. RA Camp Out, March 4th and 5th. Amen. March 4th and 5th. Any others? Going to have a wild game supper meeting right at the church in the youth room. Brother John said we're 5 weeks out. About 5 weeks out. 4 weeks out. We need to really start pushing some things. So looking forward to it. So right after church in the youth room, men, if you could meet for about 5 minutes, that'd be great. Any others? Any prayer requests this morning? I have a Brother Leon Thrift. Brother Leon Thrift is on life support as we speak. He went in. I talked to Travis yesterday. They went down yesterday to sit with him that day like they had the past week and a half, and found him on life support. They had lost him during the night, had some problems, and they brought him back. But he's on life support there now. So Brother Leon needs our prayers. So does Travis and his sisters, his sister and his brother. So we need to keep him in our prayers. God's will be done there. And I'm sure that's exactly what Brother Leon wants as well. Remember Mentor Garvin Jr., Coach Carter went home. He wasn't feeling good, so pray for Coach. Thank the men that came yesterday, our prayer breakfast we had at Sand Hill Baptist Church. Had a big group of men there yesterday. I don't know, 30, 40, maybe more men there. It's a good breakfast, good time. Any other prayer requests? The Mixons? Yes, ma'am. Mike's not sick. Well, him and Coach was together yesterday, and Coach ain't feeling good. I was with him. I feel fine. Listen, them boys need to eat more. I can tell you what's wrong. Grits. Grits will fix it. Any others? Yes, sir.
You know, Woods
17-year-old, you said? Any others? Any unspoken? I'm sorry.
Rachel Batten.
Any others? Any unspoken? Amen. Let's remember to lift each other up in prayer. And I'm looking forward to church this morning. I pray that you're getting ready. Get ready. Don't worry about your checkbook. Don't worry about your car payment. If we see a truck backed up to your car outside, don't worry about it. Don't worry about those things right now. There's more important things going on right now, and your worship to your Savior ought to be the preeminent thing that dominates your thoughts for the next hour. Let's do that. Let's give Him that. Lord, we thank You for this time together, for Your goodness You've shown us, and the praise, Lord, that I've seen people give You all this week, for I see You working and doing things in people's lives, and for ministry growing and people being involved in things, Lord, they've never been involved with, to see ministry grow. God, I just pray You'll bless, give people strength, Lord, that are doing the work, the doers of the work. God, I pray that they find fertile ground. We pray for these prayer requests, Lord, as we come to You today, realizing, Lord, that only You can heal in some of these places. And, Lord, some of these things are completely out of doctor's hands. So, God, I pray that You'll bless, You'll strengthen, You'll raise them up if it be Your will. Lord, help us to understand that everything will happen the way we would. And sometimes it takes years for us to see the bigger plan. But, God, help us to be patient and to pray and to do that without failing. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you would, please stand, visit around just for a minute.
Standing as we worship this morning. Nothing to
Such as this and worship you in song and hear your word proclaimed, Lord. Lord, as we come to this part of the service where we give back just a small portion of our things that you bless us with, Lord, we ask that you bless this tithe and offering and bless the giver, Lord. I pray, Lord, it will be used for the work of this earthly ministry, Lord. And we'll just give you the honor and the glory for credit and all. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you.
Amen. I see. Well, amen. Amen. Take your Bibles with me and look with me in Luke chapter 7. I'm bouncing around today. I've had several opportunities this week to preach God's Word, and I've enjoyed it. Listen, there's nothing better for a preacher than to have somewhere to preach. That's a big deal, and to have somewhere to share God's Word. Turn with me to Luke chapter 7. Verse 18. Luke chapter 7, verse 18. Now we're going to back up to Luke chapter 3 after this, and we're going to talk about John the Baptist just a little bit. John the Baptist is in a place here today where we're going to see him in Luke chapter 7. Dr. Luke doesn't even talk about his death. It kind of falls off the pages here. The other disciples, they talk about his death and beheaded and his head carried to Herodias or whatever her name is, and takes his head in there, and they dwell with that. Luke doesn't. I've often wondered, is that maybe if he's because is could it be because he's a doctor and he could visualize that a little more, and he didn't want to when he thinks about a friend of his dying, you know, being beheaded. Now, he didn't write this down when it happened. This is several years later, maybe when he was an older man, but probably when the Holy Spirit enlightened him to pen this letter, this gospel to paper, we find that years sometimes, when we look back on things after years, Brother Kenny, it's true, we look back on things after years of it happening and be able to look back on it, we see it differently than when it happened. It's different. We can see what God was doing. We can see how God orchestrated things to happen. We can see that we were just a part of that, that we didn't. We had very little idea in how to steer it. Some of you are here today because God's grace in your life. God's allowed you to be here. God placed a desire in your heart to be in God's house, and you're here today. Some of you have been here for a long time. And listen, that's God's will as well. And as we find ourselves in God's will, sometimes it takes a long time to be able to look back over our life and to ask ourselves a tough question. And that question is it worth it? Amen. Is it worth it? Is the gospel worth it? Is the gospel worth it? Some of you shaped your whole life around the gospel. Some of us shaped the gospel around our lives, and we shouldn't. The gospel, we have something to offer people that will save their soul. It might not be important today to them, but there's going to come a day when they will remember when you said something about Jesus to them and tried to bring them into the house of God. It'll matter. Some of you here today, we got members that ain't here no more. Listen, I'll be honest with you, Brother Ronnie, half the folks that were here when I came 4 years ago are gone. I have no idea. What I do know is the gospel's worth it, without a doubt. Listen, I would tell you, if you're going to give your life away to something, give it away to something that pays dividends. Give it to something that doesn't burn out here in a little while. You know, a lot of people put up savings or they put up retirement, and you know, the big thing is when they do that, they say, this will last you. Well, it depends on how long you last. You know, this will last you. This is enough money to keep you from now on. Well, I might want a new truck when I'm 75 years old, or I might want to go to Alaska. I might want to go to Poland. I don't know if I'm ever going to Poland, but I mean, I want to do something. You know, I don't want to sit in the house and stare out the window for the last 15 years. Listen, I don't want to put my faith in those kind of things. I want to put my faith in something that lasts, that will see me out the other end, that won't diminish one iota. It'll be worth more when I die than it is even now. The funding won't ever go away. And I'm going to tell you something, the gospel's worth it. It's worth it. Stand with me if you would. Let's read a few verses here together. And this is one of the few times I come up, I don't know exactly what verse I'm going to start with. So we're just going to jump in here somewhere, okay? Y'all right? Luke chapter 7, verse 18 says this. And the disciples of John showed him of all these things. And John, calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? This is John the Baptist's disciples. John the Baptist was the forerunner of Christ, according to the prophecy of Isaiah. And even in a few moments, the validated word of Christ himself will say that John the Baptist is, there's not a greater prophet ever walked the face of the earth than John the Baptist. Not a greater, none greater. But John the Baptist is struggling. He's at the end of his life. He knows it. Oh, you can probably bet, rumor has it, and it's made it down to his jail cell, that he's going to lose his head. He knows why he's down there. It's cost him. See, he's told Herod, and Herod liked hearing it. Herod enjoyed listening to John the Baptist and the truths that John the Baptist told him, but because he was too proud, one of God's greats would be beheaded. Now, well, why didn't God intervene? Why didn't God step out? Why didn't Jesus go over? Why didn't all these things? The Bible doesn't even say that Jesus went and seen him while he was in there. It's worth it, he tells him. It's worth it. It's worth it. Watch this. When the men were come unto him, they said, John Baptist hath sent us unto thee, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? And in the same hour he cured many of their infirmities and plagues, and of the spirits, and of many of them that were blind, he gave sight. So we read that verse and we think, what in the world does that have to do with what they're asking him? Then Jesus answering said unto them, Go your way and tell John what things you have. Tell him what you've seen and heard. How that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised. To the poor the gospel is preached, and blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Lord, we love you and we thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you for people like John the Baptist. Lord, his parents had him late in life. God, so many things happened around his life. Lord, he comes on the scene like a lightning bolt and then goes away like a distant thunder. God, I look forward to one day hearing his testimony or seeing him talking. God, my prayer is that the people that are here today will see that it's worth it, the gospel is worth it, and that there'll be a well done for them when they get home. Lord, let us not grow weary. Let us not grow faint. Let us not despise or grow offended from the gospel. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. Anybody ever seen the movie Schindler's List? I've never seen the movie, but I've read the book. I've never seen the movie. Oscar Schindler. I've read his excerpts of him. I've never seen the movie. I wouldn't know. Oscar Schindler, though, during the Holocaust era, where the Jews were being killed, Schindler got a group of Jewish people and brought them into his factory and run his factory with Jews. People say, "Well, that's a great man." No, he was a womanizer and a drunkard. He wasn't any type of moral, not much moral fiber at all. But he did have a spark of compassion for the Jewish people. There's something about him that he just could not. He had to do something. So he started getting these Jews into his factory and working the Germans out. And before you knew it, he had a factory full of 1,100 Jews that would come in there to work. And now, according to the German government, they were there in a camp and they were working, and it was making a profit, so they never bothered him. But he took care of those 1,100 Jews there in this area of his plant. And when the Germans were overthrown, Hitler committed suicide in that bunker. They were free. All of a sudden, they were free. And all the Germans that were the leaders and the people in charge of Germany were running for their lives now. The ones that were the slaves were now free. And the ones that were the captors were now being chased. So in Oscar Schindler's leaving, he goes to leave the factory. In the movie, he goes to leave the factory and the road, if you've ever seen it, the road is lined up on both sides of the Jews that he helped. And as he's walking out to his vehicle or his car or leaving out, on both sides of the road, people are saying, thank you, thank you, thank you for what you did. We know what you did. And one of the leaders in the factory, maybe plant manager, I'm not sure, gives him some papers. And those papers, it has all the people's names there that he helped and thank yous from them, little words of encouragement that he gave. You know, I've often wondered what were his thoughts, you know, at those last moments. People say, well, I wonder what he was thinking. Was he afraid? Was he worried? Was he ashamed? Here's what he said to that manager before he left out. He said, I could have done more. He said, I could have done more. He said, that car, I could have got 10 more Jews. I could have got 10 more Jews for that car. He pulled his pocket watch out, and as he wept, he held that pocket watch and said, "This I could have bribed an official and got 2 Jews with this watch." So his last thoughts before he leaves is, I could have done more. You know, I know that when I meet the Lord one day, I'll feel the same way. I could have done more. You know, this week I had to tell people I couldn't do things. A friend of mine's aunt passed away. I couldn't do the funeral. I physically could not be there to do that funeral. I feel terrible about it. Missed an opportunity. Share the gospel with somebody. I just couldn't do it. Listen, throughout our lives, we have things that come into our lives where we could present the gospel to somebody if we would, but we miss opportunities. If there's the single greatest thing, Brother Kenny, that plagues me on this side is knowing that one day I'm going to meet my Savior and I'm going to feel like I should have done more. It's going to happen. And I can promise you, if you're a Christian, you feel the same way. I should have done more. I should have done more. I like to think about John the Baptist. I've been studying him now for a couple of weeks and different things. And it's funny with John the Baptist. He comes on the scene in Luke chapter 3. Turn with me there. Let's look how bold he is in Luke chapter 3. I promise you, I won't take you to Joshua like I did Wednesday night. And Brother Mike, it's probably good he's not here, which he's here. But he got to hear me Wednesday night and Saturday on this same subject. So I just can't get it preached out of me. Reckon I'll get it preached out and we'll move on. Amen. So don't y'all look up here like that. Y'all listen to the same song over and over. So you hear the same preaching. Amen. It just gets better. You know, I just can't get it all out of me. It's like you hear that and it's still there and you almost got some more. Here in Luke chapter 3, John the Baptist is excited. That dude just come out of the wilderness. Bold. Listen, somebody bold. He's telling the publicans, the Pharisees, anybody that listens, calls them vipers. Now, they're there to hear him, and he calls them all vipers. He could have been a little nicer if you ask me. Amen? They walked out to see him at the Jordan River 6 miles outside Jericho. He could at least been friendly. I don't know. But watch this. Luke chapter 3. Let's pick up there about verse 3. And he came into all the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. See, he knew exactly why he was called. He was called to preach the remission of sins. What we do with our sins is the single greatest thing you'll ever decide. Some of you have decided to keep your sin. Some of you decided not to let God take your sin. Listen, if you don't accept Christ as your Savior, let him take your sin, you're going to spend an eternity in hell trying to pay for those sins. Listen, you don't get to go down when it's paid out and get to come out. No, it's a one-way trip, brother. Somebody has to pay your sin debt. And this morning, you ought to decide to let Jesus have that. And that's what John the Baptist came on the scene saying. He said, you got to do something with your sin. Isn't it something that he just a few months older than Jesus, and he comes in just a breath's hair in front of Jesus, their ministry start about the same time, and he comes on the scene saying, listen, you got to do something with your sin. By the way, I've got a way you can do it. I've got one here whose shoes I'm not worthy to unlatch. Watch what happens here. This is a great place in Scripture. He came into the country preaching repentance and remission of sins. As it is written in the book of the words, Isaiah the prophet, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be brought low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways shall be made smooth. All flesh, I like that, and all flesh. He didn't mean just to save people. He didn't mean just a lot. He said all flesh shall see the salvation of God. Remember that verse right there. All flesh shall see the salvation of God. That's good to me right there. Let me tell you where that takes me. That takes me to the rapture in my own mind. That takes me to the day of the rapture, whatever that day is. All flesh will see. I don't want to hurry because I got to wait on that. Then said he to the multitude that came forth to be baptized of him, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits worthy of repentance, and begin not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father, for say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. You see, the problem he was having there, or he could see that he was about to have there, is that it was a group of people that wanted to come and be baptized and still remain Jewish under the Jewish law. They get down there and they hear some good preaching, or they hear some good singing. They say, woohoo, I'm getting on board with this. And they don't even know why they're doing it. They don't ever ask for repentance. They never lay their sins down before God. I believe there's people today in our churches walking around in them, teaching in them, preaching in them, singing in them, doing all the church stuff that are lost. They've never done nothing with their sin. They got excited at a revival and went down and asked the Lord into heart, but they've never done nothing with their sin. And they wonder why it's so easy to slip in the dark and do those things that they do and nobody sees, and they think that they're okay. Those ought to be the times that bring you the greatest fear. But God's looking. He sees it. Here we have John the Baptist. He tells him, listen, you got to do something with your sin. Don't come down here saying that Abraham, that you can continue with the law and you can continue to do good things. And if you do good things, you get to go to heaven. Don't you do that. Don't you come down here with that offer. He said, and now also the axe is laid into the root of the trees. And every tree, therefore, which bringeth not forth good fruit, is honed down and cast into the fire. And the people said, what should we do? All they'd ever known. Listen, for I don't know how many generations can be in 400 years. 12, I don't know. But for the past 12 generations, past 400 years, there hadn't been a great movement. God, listen, all of heaven had shut up since Isaiah's day. 400 years, there hadn't been any open revelation at all. 400 years. Waiting and getting things prepared for Christ to come. All of a sudden, like lightning, Jesus and John the Baptist in the same place. You talking about stacking a team. God put them in the same place, same family. Hey, it's a lot harder to have a ball team like that. So they come on the scene right here, and John the Baptist gets out and starts preaching and teaching and doing those things that God had called him to do. And listen, he stuck out. People hadn't heard it like this. They'd never seen it. Listen, there was a whole group of Pharisees that learned how to do it. I forget how many laws that they had added to the Ten Commandments. They kept adding hundreds and hundreds of things they had to do, supposedly, to be right with God. If they did these things, then they were okay. Well, that's what John says. Don't you do it. Don't you think that you can follow Abraham's law and be right with God. That's not going to keep you. Please tell them. I wonder if there's people like that here today that think if they come to church on Sunday, they can do whatever they want to do on Monday. I wonder. I wonder if some people come and if they pay their tithes, they think that God's supposed to help them now. If they do this, then God should do that. Listen, God ain't Santa Claus. Amen? And listen, you ought to be serving just because God gave you breath to get up this morning. You ought to be giving just because you woke up in a free country this morning and you can get in your car and go down the store and get you a cup of coffee if you want to. Listen, the fact that God has blessed us, I think we overlook it so much. We overlook the fact that God blesses us. And so, I can remember my grandpa preaching years ago. I must have been 5 years old over at Whitehall Free Will Baptist Church over here off of Morton Street in Waycross. My grandfather used to preach over there. And I remember him preaching one day, and I don't know what, but it stuck with me my whole life. And he made this statement. He said, "Some of you on the way to church pass within 3 foot of death." I went, "What's he talking about?" He said, "Yeah," because we had to drive from Folkestone. And listen, in the 70s, from Folkestone to Waycross was like from Folkestone to West Virginia. You know, that's a long way. Especially sitting in the back of a car, you know, no seat belts. And he said, "Some of you passed within 3 foot of death on the way to church today." He said, "When you passed another car." And I thought about that. I've thought about that my whole life. When I accepted Christ as my Savior, I began to understand how God protects me. How he looks out for things that I don't even realize that he's looking out for. Listen, I took Daddy out to the swamp Thursday to fish. A gator did not eat me. That's a good day. Then we forget what God's done for us. We forget all these things that we think, well, my truck made it because I served. No, your truck made it because God blesses you, man. Listen, my family all is whole today because I've told it. No. Listen, your family's whole today because God's looked your way with compassion and he's blessed you today. Amen. And we forget where we're at and who God is in our lives. And I'm going to tell you, John the Baptist is out preaching the gospel and he's shucking the corn. He goes on to say, the people ask him then in verse 10, they say, well, what shall we do? You say that we can't live by the law anymore. Now that we've come to be baptized, how should we live? What should we do now? Here's what he goes on to say. He said unto them the publicans. Then came also the publicans and said, "Master, what shall we do?" And he said unto the publicans, "Exact no more than that which is appointed you." These are little things. Just do your job. My wife's favorite line, just do your job. And he's telling them, just go out and do your job. Then he goes, then this happens. The soldiers, there were soldiers there. Come down to be baptized. Laid their spears down, laid their quarterstaffs, laid their shields down, laid whatever down, their greaves, whatever. Got down in the water and was baptized. They said this. Likewise demanded him, saying, "And what shall we do?" He said to them, "Do violence to no man, neither accuse any falsely, and be content with your wages." And as the people were in expectation, watch this. And as the people were in expectation, all men mused in their hearts of John whether he were the Christ or not. He was at the pinnacle of his ministry, right there. Everybody thought that he might be Jesus. Look what he does. Turn the page. Well, you might not turn your page. Verse 16. John answered, saying unto them all, "I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than me cometh, the latchet of whose shoes I'm not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor." And the Jews knew what that meant. He was getting rid of the husk just to leave the valuable seed, and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff he will burn with fire unquenchable. And many other things in his exhortation preached he unto the people. We don't know what he said. So we find here that Herod gets in the scene. Man, listen, John the Baptist at the pinnacle. He's preaching, doing exactly what he's told to do, telling them straight, telling them what it is. Here we have verse 19. But Herod, the tetrarch, being reproved by him for Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, and for all the evils which Herod had done, added yet this above all, that he should shut up John in prison. So John goes to prison. Hey, after preaching the gospel, listen, after doing exactly what he's supposed to do, after going out and preaching it just like God had led him to do it, the old boy winds up in prison. He winds up in jail. Have you ever suffered for the ministry? What's it cost you to be a Christian? What's it cost you? I dare say some might say that if it hadn't cost you anything, is it worth very much? If it don't cost you much, is it worth much? You know, over the years, I made a little list, and I got feeling sorry for myself. I started making a list of all the things that I think that were bad that's happened to me since I've been saved. I've been thrown out of people's houses. Listen, I can't tell you how many ugly phone calls I've gotten over the years, how many mean texts, letters. I kept them. I want to be reminded why I do what I do. You say you keep the ugly letters? Every one of them. Every one of them. I've been uninvited to Ministerial Alliance meetings. Yeah. And didn't get invited no more. You know, they claimed I was stealing all their people. I told them if they would feed them, they'd stay. And they didn't go. That didn't go very well. I had a preacher put his hands on me one time. Yeah. In the ministry. I did the ministry. I've been chewed out by more parents than you can imagine as a youth guy. You'd be surprised what parents will allow their kids to do and will fight and argue with you to let them do it. Now, I can promise you, if you let your kid go with me somewhere, they're going to do what I tell them. I had a bunch of them, parents, I told them back in, I don't remember Brother Donald, I reckon it was in 7 or 8, I told them not to take their phone to summer camp. I didn't, Brother Vance did. I didn't tell them that. I wasn't going to. I thought it was a good idea, but I really thought they maybe should stay a group with the parents, let them be able to call their folks. Brother Vance told them no cell phones. So we got summer camp. Guess what? They cell phones. I took them. Man, you just do not know the ugliness that come out of folks over those cell phones. Listen, I look back and I was asked to leave out of a church because they had a pedophile pastor that I told he was a pedophile. Showed them proof. They didn't want to hear it. Missed family reunions over the years. We don't get to go to them. Why? This is more important. Y'all okay? Amen. Hey, listen, what I'm telling you is it's not to the place where we're feeling sorry for myself. I want you to feel sorry for me. I just want to tell you that I still think it's worth it. Hey, I'm probably going to be thrown out of more houses before this thing's over with. And I'll probably be uninvited to more churches before this thing's over with. But that's okay with me. As long as God looks my way and he's happy, bless the Lord and all God, all his things that he does. Listen, I'm thankful to be his man here at this place today. I'm thankful. Some of you here today, you've seen a lot through the ministry. You've had to go through a lot. You've had a lot of hurt in the ministry. People have, it hadn't gone your way. You think that things should be different, but you're still hanging on. Listen, is it true that sometimes you wonder why? Here's a couple of people in the Old Testament. I just want to remind you today why you do what you do for the kingdom. It's important. Some people, Miss Vaughn, are at edge. I can almost sense it. Some people are on the edge of being out. Some people are on the edge. Some of them are home today. Oh, yeah. But some of them's on the edge. I just want to remind you today why you do what you do. Listen, I like that old song. We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll work till Jesus comes and we'll be gathered home. I'm looking forward, man. I sing that all the time. I ride down the road thinking about all the stuff we got to do. Hey, we'll just work till Jesus comes. I believe the King's coming. Hey, when he gets here, listen, when he gets here, I want to be able to go through heaven and be able to look around and know I belong. Hey, listen, when those men of God are sitting around the table talking about things they did on earth, I want to be able to sit around the table and have something to talk about. A lot of people don't. Hey, there's a lot of people that come in and out of church every week, don't make a ripple in the pond at all. They just kind of coast along. They just kind of coast along. They get in the wake of somebody else and just kind of ride along. Lord, I don't want to be that. Mm-mm. I don't think you do either. Because you're going to stand before your Creator one day. And you got to give an account. You're going to stand before your Creator one day. And he goes, hey, why didn't you? Well, it was hard. Jesus is going to say, John, come here. Son, this is John the Baptist. Now tell him what you just told me. I like to look at people in the Old Testament, because some of the people in the Old Testament, listen, they had to live it every moment to be right with God. Every year they had to bring, or even when they sinned, they'd have to bring these sacrifices to the altar. But at least once a year they have to come and bring a lamb without spot or blemish, or a bullock, a male, or a dove, whatever they could afford. They had to bring that thing and offer sacrifice. I think about old Caleb in the Old Testament. Just after they promised, they passed over the Jordan River, went through Jericho, got in, and they're dividing out the land. Caleb was one of the two that espied out the land back when Moses sent him to go over the Jordan and look in the land, see what was out there. So Joshua and Caleb went out and looked into the land, and they come back and said, we can take it. But 10 of them said, no, you can't. Listen, that's too big. So they wound up on the east side of the Jordan River, wandering around for 40 years till that generation died. So here's Caleb, Brother Kenny, standing before Jacob, and he says, before Joshua, and the piece of land that he's supposed to get, he wants. Because he told him way back, he said, I want to come back to this place. And let me tell you something particular about that piece of land that Caleb wanted. There was giants in the land. It wasn't just a regular piece of land where you run a bunch of little pygmies off in it, you know, a bunch of little people. His had giants in it. It wasn't just a little regular spot. Here's what he told him. If you read through Joshua, you'll find out it was Caleb's people that went and helped the other folks run the people out of their land. Caleb, I'm thinking, I believe he's in his 80s. I can't remember the exact age, maybe 85 years old. But he's standing before Joshua. I believe he's got a spear in his hand. And he looks at Joshua and says, give me this mountain. He said, I'm as strong today to go out for war as I was 40 years ago. I can get it done. This is mine. Lord, give us Christians like that. Give us people like that, Lord, that'll stand and say, I want mine. Listen, I want to serve the God. I want to lead people. I want to do those things. Boy, I think about Caleb, it fires me up. I think about Samson. All the things that God blessed him with and gave him. And listen, he took everything and he wound up pushing a grits mill in a circle. Remember, as a little boy watching it, I thought he was pushing a cane mill around, you know, in the movies I watched when I was a little boy. They plucked his eyes out. He brought him inside and he put his hands on the pillars of that big temple or where they was at. And he pushed them down. The Bible said he killed more that day than in all the years of his life. Think about Samson. I wonder if Samson pushed those pillars out. Did it pass through his mind? I could have done more. I wonder if Caleb chased those giants out of the promised land. I wonder when his day came, did he think, I could have did more? I think about David killing Goliath, just a boy, killing a man that was a warrior from his youth, 9 feet, 9 inches tall, cut his head off. The Bible doesn't say that